of the living God, fall fresh on us.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us.
My annual address this morning comes in two parts. Part one as today's sermon, part two as the annual address that will kick off the annual meeting to follow this worship. The title of my part one address, When We Hide the Light Under the Church's Bushel Basket. The gospel is quite provocative this morning in its imagery, and I found it challenging to talk about a light under a bushel basket. For a light under the bushel basket, we cannot see nor know the condition of the light. So how do we talk about it? We can only speculate, spiritually observe, describe to the best of our abilities, and to have a conversation about that. And so today, in both part one and part two, I am initiating a conversation. I've been working with the vestry over the last couple of months. You'll hear more about that in my part two of my annual address. The vestry and I are looking at a number of matters at this point in our history. But the one thing that we are very clear about, crystal clear about, is that St. Francis Church is about the people. And people have stories. We can't be human beings without stories. Our stories shape us. The church is also the way God's story, through his son Jesus, the resurrected Christ, intersects with our stories. His story and our story overlap, or so it should. When God's story and our story intersect, we are able to see the radiant light of Christ everywhere. When God's story and our stories are incongruent, then the light is hidden under the bushel basket. Sometimes our church buildings become the bushel basket where, despite our very best efforts, we hide the light of Christ, and not as many people see the light as we would wish. Church buildings hold many cherished stories. Each part of this place has a story attached to it. Some I've come to know over the last 5 years, and some I'm still seeking to hear. You may be the one who contributed to our pews, and these have a special meaning for you. Every time I use the new ciborium that contains the hosts donated by the Brown family, I think about Harry and his story among us and how he touched me profoundly. There's a miniature red wagon at the back in the columbarium to remind us of the past cherished red wagon ministry. There's a carving on the back wall to remind us of members who gave us and offered this community their gifts to this church, particularly as carpenters. And many of you have a loved one in the columbarium, reminding you every single Sunday of even more stories in this place. I'm confident that you each have stories that are not even connected to a sacred vessel, pew, or picture, but rather the Spirit-filled liturgical actions and sermons that have taken place in this sacred place. Church buildings are more than a collection of sacred things that tell a story or spaces where important milestones take place. I want to introduce you to a concept that might be new to you. It's new to many people I talk to. Church buildings also tell unspoken stories. These unspoken stories are never narrated, never told, but no less significant in the way these narratives have shaped us as a community. Deep into the unconsciousness of a church's founders is a silently narrated story, infused into every brick of the new church building. This church building, then, in the coming decades, draws to it people that are energized by this same unspoken story, this very unique way of encountering sacred reality. The unspoken story that is built into the very walls of the church is one of the ways that churches show the light of Christ, and also one of the ways churches also hide the light of Christ under its bushel basket. The church building so easily becomes the bushel basket where we reveal the light of Christ, but where we also unconsciously hide the light. Before I came to St. Francis, I know most of you know this, well, you don't know the story, but you know I served at St. Stephen's Church in Reno, Nevada. St. Stephen's was a great congregation of people deeply committed to each other, to ministry, and to God. Over their life at St. Stephen's, this lovely congregation suffered tremendously. In the early 60s, St. Stephen's built a beautiful church on a large plot of gifted land. The altar and the back hanging were hand-carved in memory of one of their first parishioners, a woman who died when she was hit by a car, riding her bike one early Christmas morning. Over the years, very few people knew her tragic story, but they venerated the altar, and that altar, I believe, shaped their unfolding congregational story. Fast forward, I was the first compensated priest hired in over 30 years, as their previous seminary-trained compensated priests betrayed their trust and sexually molested some of their children. Two children who had been molested committed suicide. This abuse, repeated many times by different priests to different children over a period of 30 years. Again and again, the death of the young woman riding her bike inscribed into the altar was re-inscribed into the body of this congregation. The parish was crucified. The parish also literally faced the crucified Christ, this beautiful image of the crucified Christ, as they faced the altar every Sunday morning. And so, in their worship, they became the crucified Christ. They understood their story through the crucifixion. While the people faced the crucified Christ, they also had their backs to an amazing floor-to-ceiling risen Christ stained glass window where the sun shone through, revealing brilliant colors. One Pentecost Sunday, after much healing work was accomplished, as my Pentecost gift to the people of St. Stephen's, and with some conversation with the vestry. I moved the altar from the front underneath the crucified Christ and placed it at the back near the foot of the risen Christ, where we then had our Sunday service. I removed the altar to help the people of St. Stephen's align their renewed healed story from crucifixion to leaning in to resurrection and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in Pentecost. The moving of the altar was the beginning of acknowledging, naming, and narrating a new story. Beginning that Pentecost Sunday, the people of St. Stephen's began to turn towards life and away from being paralyzed by the many deaths they had earlier witnessed. Due to their profound physical, emotional, and spiritual turn, St. Stephen's church building no longer told their story and the healed experience of resurrection of this congregation. The strength of their collective healing compelled the people of St. Stephen's to rethink their story in that place. And after many months of prayer and discernment, they decided to close their building and to disperse into three other local Episcopal congregations. The point of the story is really critical at this point in my sermon. They did not close because they ran out of money, though their reserves were only about 30,000. They did not close because they lacked lay leaders, though they were a church of less than 40 people. They closed their church building because the story of the building told was incongruent with their new life. Every single member of St. Stephen's went to another local Episcopal church and has reported incredible restoration in their life of ministry. Each member experienced profound resurrection. I've heard that a number of St. Stephen's people became vestry leaders and ministers in other local Episcopal congregations, some even bringing new ministries. The people of St. Stephen's spiritually heard and were physically moved by today's gospel. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but onto the lampstand and gives it light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Like St. Stephen's in Reno, St. Francis's church buildings also tell an unspoken story, or stories, deeply connected to who this congregation once was, and less so, of who this congregation has become. I don't know a lot about your early beginnings. I did learn a little bit from the Methan family when I did a memorial service a couple of years ago. I learned from them that the earliest members, and many of you may not know this, the earliest members of St. Francis Church left Trinity Cathedral after a dispute with their then dean. Those six couples turned away from the cathedral and were also alienated from the diocese. These couples led the establishment of a new church in this place. Their wounds and alienation, as much as the joy and the magnificence, are silently contained in this building and on this campus. I've been struck by the way the buildings reflect part of this early history. I've always been struck by the way our front doors to our church are not facing the street, or if you will, they do not face the outside world. In some way, the open courtyard might reflect a desire for immediate freedom at any angle, but also the insular nature of maybe the way those first members felt hurt by Trinity Cathedral. If this is true, and we cannot flawlessly read the unconscious of the architect and the architects to come, those first six couples, or even the way future generations here at St. Francis made similar choices. You and I have only the architectural results to speculate about with each other. The decisions made about the placement of the church doors in part might explain why people still to this day have a challenging time finding this place, even when they're standing right in front of it. There's another unspoken story that has conveyed something of the way the history of our parish is reflected in choices of where things are placed. I recall in my first year or two how much stuff was placed in front of the window of St. Francis and Mission. That window reads, "Francis takes God's church to the world." And when I came, you could not read that because stuff was piled in front of it. In those first years, this is how this works, that there is a silent story by the choices of where we place things unconsciously that aligns often perfectly. So at a time in your history when you did not have a clear sense of mission and outreach, your window taking church to the world was blocked. You worked hard with Pastor Marcia to grow this church back to its peak days. But even with your efforts and desires, growth did not materialize. As you will hear from Ken Steen at our annual meeting today, we have a steady decline of pledge with loss of members through death, relocation, and some members who have found other spiritual homes. With me as your priest in charge, you have built an incredible spirit of a coherent mission and outreach with increasing visibility in the community. Your light is coming out from under the bushel basket. And at the same time, this church building and the way it was erected continues to partially conceal our emerging light as a congregation. It's a paradox that we have fewer people and we have produced more for others through education for ministry, the senior produce market, and our outreach partners, to name just a few ways the light of Christ shines through us. The Dean of Trinity Cathedral was our guest several times last year in ways that demonstrate that the people of this church have found healing that our first St. Francis members could not find for themselves. It is my sense, though, that our church building and its very early positioning has become increasingly incongruent with an emerging new story of St. Francis. St. Francis's church has spiritually and ministerially far surpassed its wounded early days of breaking apart from the cathedral church and diocese and all the unspoken stories of the past. The light of Christ shines through each of you brighter than ever before. I truly believe this. Nevertheless, it is still hard for others to see the light we see due to the positioning of our campus and, for example, where the church doors are located. So my sermon will come to an unusually abrupt conclusion as I will continue with my annual address. But I see some questions for you as we continue to enter worship together. Questions that I hope that you will pray over in the coming weeks and months. Where will the Spirit lead all of you next with this little light of yours that is not so little anymore? And here is one of my fundamental questions to my sermon this morning. And it's not a question that I can answer for you. I can only raise the questions for the vestry and for the congregation. How important is it to you, each of you, to have a congruent story with where you worship? How important is it for you to have a congruent story? And will you seek congruence between your renewed story and where and how you are a church in the future to your neighbors? Will you sing with all your heart and spirit our closing hymn, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. In my annual address following our Sunday morning liturgy, I will continue my reflections and offer additional insights about the way we might take the light of Christ out from under our St. Francis Church bushel basket. God bless you.